Hello. In this video, we will continue to study the spectrum and the resolvent set of a bounded linear operator, but we will now focus on the spectral theory of self-adjoint operators on a Hilbert space X. By definition, T is self-adjoint if the adjoint of T is the operator itself. Even though this condition is quite strong, self-adjoint operators are a very important special class of bounded operators, similarly as symmetric and Hermitian matrices are important special classes of square matrices. And in this video we will highlight a few of the main special spectral properties of self-adjoint operators. Perhaps a couple of the most fundamental spectral properties of self-adjoint operators are presented in this first theorem, which states that the spectrum of a self-adjoint T is always a subset of the real axis, and that the residual spectrum of T is always empty. The property that the residual spectrum is empty means precisely that the range of lambda I minus T is dense whenever the operator is injective. Otherwise, there are no restrictions on the types of the spectrum, and a self-adjoint operator can have a spectrum consisting only of eigenvalues, only of continuous spectrum, or having both of these types of spectrum. And since we recall that the spectrum of a bounded operator is always a bounded set contained in a disk with radius equal to the norm of T, the spectrum of a self-adjoint operator is always contained in a closed real line from minus the norm of T to the norm of T. And we can now sketch the proof of this result. We begin by outlining how to deduce that T cannot have any residual spectrum. To do this, it is sufficient to show that for any lambda, the injectivity of the operator lambda I minus T implies that the orthogonal complement of the range of lambda I minus T is the trivial subspace, which is equivalent to the range of lambda I minus T being dense in the space X. To this end, we assume that lambda I minus T is injective and take an arbitrary Y from the complement of the range. By definition, Y is orthogonal with respect to any elements from the range of lambda I minus T. And we can now use the self-adjointness of T to move the operator to the second component of the inner product, introducing a complex conjugate to the scalar lambda. Since this inner product is zero for all vectors X, the vector in this second component must necessarily be zero. And because of this, Y belongs to the kernel of conjugate lambda I minus T. Since what we have here is a set of equivalences, we have that the complement of the range of lambda I minus T in fact coincides with the kernel shown here. In the second part of the proof, we can further use the self-adjointness of T to show that the kernel of the operator conjugate lambda I minus T is also equal to the kernel of lambda I minus T, now without the complex conjugate. And combining these properties, the orthogonal complement of the range of lambda I minus T is equal to the kernel of lambda I minus T, and in particular, it is the trivial subspace since lambda I minus T was assumed to be injective, and therefore the proof is complete. the proof of the property that the spectrum of a self-adjoint operator belongs to the real axis is left as an exercise in the lecture notes, but we can quickly discuss its main parts here. Since we already proved that T cannot have any residual spectrum, our earlier results can be used to argue that any complex value lambda is a spectral point of T, if and only if there exists a sequence of unit vectors xk such that the images of these vectors under lambda I minus t converges to zero as k goes to infinity. In the second part, we can show that if we take a lambda with a non-zero imaginary part ib, then for any x, the norm of lambda I minus t x is bounded from below by the modulus of b times the norm of x. Using this estimate, you can show that the sequence xk, the so-called approximate eigenvector in the first part, cannot exist when lambda has a non-zero imaginary part. Self-adjoint operators have quite a few different and very nice spectral properties, and on this course we have chance to only cover a fraction of these. On this slide we only highlight two further properties which also play important roles in the proofs of our later results. We already saw that the spectrum of a self-adjoint operator is contained in the interval from minus the norm of t to norm of t. And the first result here shows that at least one of the endpoints of the interval belongs to the spectrum of the operator t. This shows in particular that the disk centered at zero and having a radius of equal to the norm of t, which we saw to contain the spectrum of any operator, is really minimal in the case of a self-adjoint operator. And this result also has the consequence that we can determine the norm of a self-adjoint operator completely from its spectrum, and in particular, if the spectrum of T only consists of the point zero, then T is necessarily the zero operator. This relationship is really special property of self-adjoint operator, and it fails even in the case of matrices if we do not have the required symmetry or Hermitian property. And finally, we also note that the eigenvectors of a self-adjoint operator corresponding to two eigenvalues which are distinct are always orthogonal with respect to each other. This property is also something that is familiar from the case of Hermitian and symmetric matrices, and the proof in the case of a self-adjoint operator on a Hilbert space can be completed as in the same way as in the matrix case. We can now consider an example of the spectral analysis of a concrete self-adjoint operator. And in this example, we consider an integral operator T on the Hilbert space L2 of square integrable functions on the interval from A to B. We assume that the kernel of the integral operator is a uniformly continuous function of two variables, and we define t so that tf is a function whose value at t is given as the integral of the product of k and f over s. We can begin by identifying the adjoint of the operator t. A direct computation using the definition of the inner product on L2 and Fubini's theorem will lead to the conclusion that the adjoint of T is in fact another integral operator whose kernel is related to K, but so that the order of the arguments T and S is reversed and its values are conjugated. Because of this, we can conclude that T is a self-adjoint operator if the kernel K is such that its value at T and S is the same as the complex conjugate of its value at S and T. Since in fact the kernel of our integral operators are unique, this is in fact also a necessary condition for the self-adjointness of T. As a more concrete case, we can focus on the situation where the kernel is separable in the sense that it can be written as a sum of products of functions of T and S only. The analysis generalizes easily to the case of a greater number of terms, but here we can focus on the situation where K consists of two terms, each of them being a real scalar multiple of a function K of T and the complex conjugate of the same function with argument S. In this situation, it's possible to compute the non-zero eigenvalues and eigenvectors of T explicitly. Indeed, these eigenvalues can be solved from a finite dimensional eigenvalue problem with a 2x2 coefficient matrix, and the elements of this matrix, HAM, have integral formulas which are exactly L2 inner products between the functions kj and km, and they can be computed explicitly for a concrete kernel. Under our assumptions, the two-dimensional eigenvalue problem has only non-zero eigenvalues and a full number of linearly independent eigenvectors. These eigenvectors also determine the actual eigenfunctions of T corresponding to lambda, so that we get an eigenfunction of f corresponding to lambda if we take linear combinations of the functions k1 and k2 with the coefficients alpha1 and alpha2 coming from the eigenvector of the finite dimensional eigenvalue problem. The derivation for the eigenvalue problem and the forms of the eigenfunctions are presented in detail in the lecture notes. The outline of the argument is that if K is separable, then for any function f, the image TF is necessarily a linear combination of K1 and K2. Because of this, the eigenvalue equation implies that any eigenvector corresponding to a non-zero lambda must also be a linear combination of k1 and k2 with some coefficients alpha1 and alpha2. And if we then substitute this form of f back into the eigenvalue equation, we can derive the condition for the coefficients of alpha1 and alpha2, which turns out to be precisely the two-dimensional eigenvalue problem.